So now let's look at some, you know, special kinds of, you know, forces whose work we would typically want to compute. So the first one we'll discuss is gravity. So let's look at work done by gravity. And we will indicate this as W sub G. Okay. So work done by gravity. Let's say we have a particle that's moving along this path. All right. And this path is, let's say, in a vertical plane. Okay. And the particle is here. All right. So the force acting on it is mg. There could be other forces as well, but let's just focus on mg or the gravity right now. And this particle is moving along this path. Let's say, you know, it goes from, I'm going to choose a horizontal position, which I'm going to call datum. Okay. So when it comes to measuring the work done by gravity, when a particle moves from one position to another position, typically we will need what we call a horizontal reference line. Okay. Which, for which the technical term is datum. Okay. And from that datum or horizontal reference line, we will measure how far vertically up or down the particle is. Okay. So initially the particle is here. Let's say this is position one. And then, you know, finally it is at position two. We would say that, okay, upward is positive y direction, because I need to have a positive direction and a variable, right? So we'll say this is from here to here, from datum is y1, and from here to here is y2. Now the choice of datum is pretty arbitrary, okay? So this is arbitrary. As long as you choose one horizontal line as reference, you can locate this datum anywhere you want, and it does not change anything, and you will see this pretty soon, okay? All right, so the particle is moved from position one to position two, somewhere in between is here, okay? And that's the force acting on it. So clearly the particle is moving in an xy plane. Let's say this is my positive x-axis. So which means that dr is dx I hat plus dy j hat, right? And what about the forces? Forces are only minus mg, and that's along negative j direction, right? So we're writing the force, the differential displacement. Now we can write the differential work, which is f dot dr, and that is minus mg j hat dot dx I hat plus this. So j dot I is zero, so we get minus mg dy, right? J dot j is one, and that's the differential work done. So we can get the total work done by integrating this, and this is minus mg, because this is constant, I will take it outside. Integral dy going from y1 to y2. So this is minus mg y2 minus y1. So let me write this again here. So w is equal to minus mg y2 minus y1, which I can also write as minus mg delta y. Okay, so delta in dynamics at least will always be final of something minus initial of something. Okay, so in this case we're writing delta y, so this is delta y is y of final minus y initial. Okay, so final over here is y2 and initial is y1, so this is also equal to y2 minus y1. So anytime I write delta, just remember delta is always final something minus initial something. So the work done due to gravity we just found is equal to minus mg delta y. Okay, now of course you don't have to remember this expression. Of course, if you remember, that's great. You don't have to, because if you are looking for work done due to gravity, and if you remember your basic definition for work, which is this, then you can always get to this, right? Okay, so let's look at this expression. This is a very interesting expression. This expression is telling you that the work done due to gravity is really not dependent on the path that the particle takes, right? Because all we have over here is the final y value minus initial y value, right? Which means that this particle could actually move along other paths. something like maybe this, or this, or this, which is another color. Or it could even go down, and then it could travel horizontally like this, and then it could go up. So any of these paths will give you the work done. Okay, same work done. Why? Because your final y and initial y are identical, and this expression actually has no information about the path that the particle takes in moving from its initial position to final position. So what we write over here is that this is independent of the path. Now remember, in general, that is not true, because as we have seen before, the work done is actually a line integral, right? So it depends on what the path is. But it turns out, in case of gravity at least, it is not dependent on the path. Okay, and such forces, the mg, this force is called a conservative force. The reason why it's called conservative force will become clear to you in next 15-20 minutes. Okay, so it's called a conservative force. All right, so gravity is good. Another kind of force that we often see, at least in engineering dynamics class, is the spring forces, or what we call linear elastic forces. So let's look at the work done by linear elastic forces. Okay, so what are the linear elastic forces? Well, they are given by the Hooke's law, which says that if you have an element, a spring-like element, and you stretch it by amount x, okay, and the force applied on the particle is F, then that force is proportional to the displacement, right? So that's the Hooke's law. So what we're looking for is the work done due to this kind of force. Okay, so we have to assume a positive direction. So let me redraw this figure, because, you know, typically we think of right hand side as positive. So I'll draw my particle to the right hand side. Okay, and I'm going to pull this by an amount dx, and under the influence of force F. Okay, so F is equal to K times X, right? So that's the total stretch, and while dx is differential stretch, or the differential displacement. So definition of the work is integral dW, which is integral F dot dr. Okay, so let's say this is my positive X direction, right? So this will be F I hat dot dr, in this case is just dx, that's also I hat. So that gives you f dx, right? Integral f dx. And f is equal to kx, but the force on the particle, the force of kx on the particle, if you draw a free body diagram, is this, right? In the opposite direction, because the spring is being stretched. So this will be minus kx dx, all right? So k is constant, I take it outside, I get x dx. And let's say the spring is stretched by amount from x1 to x2, so this gives you minus k 1/2 x2 square minus 1/2 x1 square, right? So I can write this also as minus 1/2 k x2 square minus 1/2 k x1 square. Okay, so if you look at this again, you see that something similar to what happened with the gravity is happening here, right? So over here we saw that the work done due to gravity was not dependent on the path. It was only dependent on the initial and final position. Same is true over here. You see, how the spring is stretched is not something that is captured in this expression. The only information that we have over here is about what the final stretch is, which is x2, and what the initial stretch is. Mind you, the x2 and x1 are not the length of the springs. That's a very commonly made mistake by the students. So remember, x2 and x1 are not the length of the spring, but they are actual deformation. So they could be an extension or they could be a compression. Now in this case, this expression of the work done due to elastic forces is not going to change whether you have a compression or deformation, because these terms are actually squared, right? So even if they have a negative quantity, which would be the case for compression, they would still be positive, right? So you can see that even in this case, because the work done by elastic forces is not dependent on the path, we call the spring force Kx to be a conservative force. So far we have looked at two examples, right? One, the work done by gravity, the other one, work done by linear elastic forces. And this time you may be wondering, so what kind of forces actually depend on the path? Well, that is actually a very simple example. Friction forces. So, for example, if let's say I give you a particle and I tell you that this particle is sliding over this surface and the coefficient of kinetic friction coefficient of kinetic friction is mu k, then you can compute the work done by the friction forces. So let's draw free body diagram. There's no escaping drawing free body diagram, by the way. So you have the weight, the normal reaction, and let's say this is moving in this direction, so that's differential displacement. Then friction force is mu kn. Clearly the friction force F sub F is mu k times mg, because n is balanced by mg in this case, right? Okay, so what is the work done due to friction force? It will be mu k mg, right? And that's pointing along negative direction, so that will be minus mg I hat dot dr, which is dx I hat, right? And we have to integrate it. So we get minus mu k mg, which comes outside, and inside integral, we get just dx, okay? So we get that, right? So that's the work done due to friction force. So you know that if you have this particle go from here to, let's say, here, okay? You know, this is the distance traveled, right? You will do work in going from here to here, okay? But then, if you come back to the original position, it's not like that your work has become zero because you came back to original position, right? Whatever work you did in going from here to here, you'll have to add that work when you come back as well, right? So it is clearly not just dependent on the final and initial position. Let me give you another example. Let's say I have a plane. This is my plane. And I have a puck on this plane, all right? And this puck can travel from this position, let's say initial position one, to here, okay? That's this final position. Right, I can have it travel along this path. In this case, the work done due to friction would be minus mu k n times whatever this distance is. Let's say this distance is d1, right? On the other hand, I can have this puck go from 1 to 2 along, let's say, a semicircular path, right? Where the radius is d1 by 2. In this case, the work done due to friction would be minus mu k n times this distance along this path, right? So it's actual path travel that will determine what the work done is, right? So this would be equal to, this is d1, so the solar circumference is pi d1, so that would be pi d1 over 2, right? And clearly, these two work done are different. So the work done in general by friction forces will depend on the path taken by the particle.